So you were talking, your post specifically talked about linear periodization and why there are some reasons that you don't recommend it for the tactical population. And we've had this conversation, you know, there are a lot of programs out there based on linear periodization. Mm-hmm. And while that might make sense for some populations, it may not make sense for those individuals operating in the tactical space. So let's talk about that. What was the idea behind that post?
I think that I was either listening to a podcast or I might've been reading something, but it's just, we get so stuck in our own ways as coaches, you know, what we learned in school and then, or what we learned from our mentor and whatever we learned, that's what we're going to do throughout our whole career. We're not going to look anywhere else, right? We're not going to, you know, this is how it's going to be. Linear periodization. We're going to follow this model. I don't care about your job or what goes on in your life. Like, this is what we're going to do. You can't be like that if you work in a tactical space. You have to be a chameleon. You have to be able to change with your environment, right? So, and that's where the linear model versus the nonlinear model comes in. In a tactical space, a linear model really doesn't work because the job changes all the time. Plus, if you work, especially in spec ops, these guys want to train up for marathons. Maybe the next month they want to train up for an elk hunt. And then the next month they want to try to hit 500 on their deadlift. Their goals change all the time, right? So for me, the best kind of model is nonlinear, which is more of a conjugate style approach. Of course, with a lot of energy system development conditioning in it, because we all know they like to run and condition. It just allows for more, let's just say more freedom when it comes to training. So when they're able to come in and, you know, you don't have to hit this certain percentage on a certain day, because you might be crushed because you didn't get sleep. Y'all had to do night hits and you had to do CQB early in the morning and all day in the heat. And then you come in and then I'm asking you to hit 90% on back squat. Well, guess what? That's probably going to feel like crap. And you can't just be assigned to a certain percentage. And like I told you earlier, I'm not even using percentages with my guys anymore. So it's just basically all feel. So whatever week that is, no matter what, if I'm asking you to hit a heavy single, that's going to be your heavy single for that day. You might feel like crap. So that single might be a little lighter than it will be in three weeks ahead, but it's still your heavy single for that day. It's just learning your body. It allows your body to have a little bit of freedom, and it's good for your joints. It's good for your health. And to me, it just works a little bit better, you know?
Well, I think that's a mark of a good coach too, right? So even with my nutrition programming, the goal of nutrition coaching, yep, at least when you're working with me, is that we're getting you to a point where you can eventually self-manage a little bit better, exactly, right? I'm not just writing you meal plans for the sake of writing you meal plans or whatnot, right? Like, I'm actually educating you on how to take control of that a little bit more, be a little, yep, bit more intuitive with it. So, I mean, that sounds kind of similar, and not even for military athletes. So I have firefighters that I work with. I have law enforcement that I work with who just really struggle with some of the programming that follows that linear periodization model, because they don't have the time.
They don't
have the schedule. They don't recover well all the time.
Yeah. And that's where, you know, and I'm guilty of it. I think we've all been there. I think we've all, you know, we've tried the CrossFit thing. We've tried the HIIT training. We've done all that stuff, right? And some people really enjoy it. Like, I've got guys that love CrossFit and they stick with it. But is it the best for them? I don't think so. But they enjoy it, and that's half the battle. That's the people that kind of bash CrossFit all the time. Like, you know, I give CrossFit a hard time because I don't agree with some of their, I don't agree with just HIIT all the time, right?
And I would say the reality of some of those high level CrossFit athletes is they're not doing that all the time. I think there's a big misconception around that too.
Yep. And look at your best CrossFitters out there, right? Your Tia Claire Toomey's, your Matt Frazier's, your Rich Froning's. If you pay attention to how they train, they're on strength cycles, you know, they're doing different things, not just metabolic conditioning. Like, Froning is very smart with his metabolic conditioning. He understands energy systems. He understands where to place things, you know, because he has a strength conditioning background a little bit himself. So, and Matt Frazier was an Olympic lifter. So they understand programming a little bit. And that's where it comes in. Like, with, and going back to the linear model, you tend to lose some of those things as time goes on. Like if I'm just doing power work for 8 weeks, well, where is the strength and hypertrophy going to go? As a tactical athlete, you can't afford to lose those things, right? Like you can't afford just to neglect those things for 8 to 10 weeks at a time. So that's where hitting those conjugate miles, hitting that minimal effective dose every day will be able to kind of, again, hypertrophy is crucial. Like 80% of that work needs to be hypertrophy and high rep stuff. So it's easy on the joints. It allows for lean muscle growth. All that stuff helps. And, you know, obviously there's a lot more to it when it comes to science and periodization, how programs should run. But again, it's just not hitting heavy all the time, every single day, every single day. I mean, some people think that's good for them and that's really not. You're really going on red. Your body's just adapting to a lower level of performance. You think you're adapting, but you're adapting to a lower level of performance.
Yeah. And there's a lot of guys that I work with that they go in there 3-4 days a week and they feel like they got to hit a PR every single day.
Yeah.
Nope. And right. And then just in terms of body composition. So I do work with overweight military athletes as well. Mm-hmm. And in the sector that I'm in. And so getting them to understand a little bit about how that's not necessarily going to be beneficial also in terms of just maintaining healthy body composition can be a little bit of a challenge.
Oh, absolutely.
And you talk about energy system development, and this is something that I teach from a nutrition standpoint too, really just in terms of substrate utilization and how to manage your nutrition appropriately based on your training program, right? Mm-hmm. Because your training program is what dictates your nutrition, you know, in along with whatever it is that your goal is, right?
100%.
So, I mean, when you're talking about energy system development, right, from a training standpoint, you know, and then we're talking about nonlinear periodization when we're training those energy systems, you know, talk a little bit about that, kind of explain that to some individuals who maybe have been doing linear periodization for a while and don't really understand how energy system development can be important.
Yeah. So this is a huge topic that I've got, that I've got people that's messaged me and be like, I want to know more about this energy system stuff. Cause people just don't know anything about it. Mm-hmm. Nothing. Right. So the first thing I tell people is, hey, make sure like wear a good quality heart rate monitor, right? Like buy a good chest strap. Don't go off your watch. Like know where your heart rate's sitting at all times, because a lot of my programming is going to be off that. So energy system development, right? The majority of people don't realize where their heart is sitting during training. So a lot of people that's doing this CrossFit metabolic conditioning every single day, they are crushing it, and their heart rate is just super high and they don't even realize, and they don't realize why their body starts to just deplete, you know, later in the week, or maybe they might not be able to put consistent days together. Well, it's because one, their central nervous system's not recovering. Two, they're probably, like you said, they're probably not eating right for the task at hand. And it's just, again, they got to be able to program that properly. Like I believe that high intensity training is short lived. Right? The research is out there. So high intensity training, you'll be able to see results right away, but later down the road, it's eventually going to plateau. That's why I tell people to always throw in extra, some more aerobic days. So replace 3 or 4 days with steady state aerobic work, because that's going to help. One, it's going to help you with your lifts. Two, it's going to help you recover. And three, it's going to be more sustainable for longevity down the road. I mean, you can throw in heart health and when you get older, I mean, that stuff's going to be way more important than high intensity training will be. So that's the number one thing that people don't realize. Like when people go on runs, and again, the military, we run all the time. I'm like, hey, like, do you even know where your heart rate's sitting? You say you're going for a 3 or 4 mile run, but are you hitting threshold? Is your heart rate too high? Where is it sitting at? So like, if I want you to do steady state and I see your heart rate was average of 170, well, that's not steady state at all. You're probably way above, that's probably high threshold for you. So like walk, or when you hit hills, walk, don't run them and stay, stuff like that. So I always, more people need more aerobic work, slow, steady work, less high intensity lactic work and alactic work, right? So that's where kind of those three energy systems, you got the alactic, the lactic, and the aerobic system. Lactic is probably the less common of them all. Like a lot of people stay in the lactic zone, the lactic area, and it's probably the least energy system they need to train. You either probably need to hit alactic and aerobic. Those are the ones, those where you're going to make the most money, right? Yeah. And a lot of people don't realize when you want to train alactic energy system, That's true power, right? That's, it's all about energy. So how much energy, alactic is short, powerful bursts, and you'll be able to restore ATP and rest for a long period of time, like 1 to 6, 1 to 7, and then repeat that bout. It's about repeatability. And they're like, man, like, why you got me resting 2 or 3 minutes between sets? That's purposeful. Like, trust the process, right? You need to do that. So that's alactic. And then aerobic is probably the hardest thing for people to concentrate because it's super easy. Right. Nobody wants to do anything easy, conversational, like they want to get after it all the time. That's the hardest.
If you're not
thing.
Dying, you didn't really work out, right?
Exactly. Right. If you're not crawling on the floor and leaving your sweat stain on the floor, you didn't do anything. So,
well, and even when people are working that lactic energy system, right? So we're using primarily glycolysis.
Yep.
Right. So talking about substrate utilization, and this is where people really get stuck sometimes on the nutrition side, because what's the trendy thing now? Everybody wants to eliminate carbohydrates, over protein themselves to death. Yeah. Right. So I get a lot of guys in my office who are like, oh, I'm intermittent fasting, but I feel terrible. Mm-hmm. Or they're doing very low carb diets in an effort to lose excess body fat. Or even individuals who are in great shape will come in and are doing things like that. And they don't really understand how those energy systems work. Right. And then let's talk about, you know, conventional forces. They do PT in the morning and they don't like to eat before they do PT in the morning.
Yep.
Right. So that's been a huge, just big uphill battle on my side, just with helping them learn how to sort of develop those energy systems from a nutrition standpoint, right?
I give y'all credit because dietitians got some of the hardest jobs. I sit there and watch some of the questions that come in, and I see, again, when guys, going back to the energy system thing, when guys want to combine those, like when they want to, they're doing anaerobic work, which is basically lifting, right? And then they'll go try to do a 3 or 4 mile, which is aerobic. Like, they're throwing all these things at you as a dietitian, and you're like, hey, like, you know, you got to understand energy systems, man. Like, those two systems right there are compromising each other. You're not gaining anything from that. It's the hardest thing, you know. And then they, you know, they hear a podcast, they hear Joe Rogan, and they want to try this, or they see the Liver King and do some of the stupid stuff he's doing. Like, there's so many things that gets thrown at dietitians. Like, I'm like, oh my gosh, like, it drives me crazy. I can't imagine what y'all go through.
Oh, I get a Liver King post either sent to me, or I get tagged in one at least twice a week. But yeah, absolutely. So, energy systems, not only from a training standpoint, from a nutrition standpoint, I feel like that's really, if you're someone who really, wants to understand a little bit more about how to take your performance kind of to that next level, right? Outside of what the masses are doing, right? So a lot of bro lifting happening, right? A lot of just random stuff happening. I feel like energy systems is kind of the next step for some people.
Absolutely it is.
But having someone who can teach you how to do it appropriately is important.
Exactly. And we try to have classes. I try to bring my guys in and invite them to any kind of like whiteboard sessions where I'm like, hey man, like let's sit down and talk about energy systems and get y'all to understand, like, cause they want to, I got to admit, like, there's guys that do a lot of extra work on their own. But I try to get them to understand, like, hey, if you do extra work, here's how you should space it out. Like, if you want to get more running or cycling in, well, try to do that in the AM, separate your lifts and your other work, from, you know, 4 to 6 hours. So at least give your systems a little bit of rest, right? Like, if you're doing stuff on the same day, and they try to pile everything in together and do all this extra work, and they're really not seeing any benefit from it because they're doing too much.
Yeah. And I would argue, you know, especially at your level working in the tactical space, you know, everybody focuses on training, right? How much emphasis do you see on the recovery side, right?
Yeah.
So,
I mean, that's not, they want to, right? It's in the back of their mind that they know they should. But again, they're just go all the time, you know? So it's like, how do we find that happy medium where we can get them to understand, like, hey, like, you need to just relax a little bit. Like, sometimes you need to, you know, again, we're lucky enough to have some of those resources where we're at, where we have like the red light beds and, you know, the sauna and the Normatex and all this stuff, like, but they still don't get utilized like they should. You know, they still don't use it. We got the cold tubs, the hot tubs, they get all the information in the handouts and everything. But, I actually have to program that stuff in because we use the Bridge app with most of our guys, and I put it in there. It's almost like a lot of guys like to check things off. right? They love checking things off. So I actually have to put it in there. Like, hey, sauna, like 20 minutes minimum, boom, like hot, light bed, boom. Like, so they can see it in front of their face. Cause if they don't see it, then they're like, okay, my day's done. Boom. I'm just going to the next thing.
Yeah. And I do the same with my athletes, right? So when they're doing their weekly check-ins with me, it's always, okay, how's sleep this week? Stress, mm-hmm. you know, did you hit all your training this week? How did it feel? Yeah. And then of course the nutrition piece as well.
Yeah.
Cause there's just not enough emphasis on that. And it, not even in the military, right? Just in, even in law enforcement and the fire service.
All they care about is, you know, getting their blood work and their DEXA scans and just comparing their testosterone.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much it.
That's the truth.